Talking to you this morning about your end. And sometimes we live our whole Christian life concentrating about the current situation. And the victory and the joy of your salvation lies in the end. What is coming? And this morning I want to focus on that. I want to take your focus off the storms of this world. I want to take it off the people around you. You know, people will always do something that you don't want them to do. And situations will always happen. And when we live our life overcome by these things that are happening here, right now, we lose focus on what's important. And what's important is eternity. Hallelujah. Amen. And I want you to understand this morning, the key to your success, the key to you living a fulfilled life is having a revelation of what is coming. And many times we don't hear these messages anymore. But when you read, when you look at the oldies, I like the old tent revival videos where people are holding onto the poles of the tent because they feel the fire of hell burning at their feet. I believe that the modern day church has forgotten that there is a hell to shun and there is a heaven to gain. We're too concerned about the blessings and the cars and the houses and the promotions. We're too concerned about all these things. All we want to pray to God, oh Lord, bless us, bless us, bless us, bless our business, bless this, bless the works of our hands, give us money, give us all that our heart desires. But God is saying, I've already given you the greatest gift of all. The Bible speaks of something. The Bible says that your life on the earth is 70 years. And after 70 years, it's grace. So let's give and take grace for 10 years. If you're lucky, you live 80 or plus, and then you're done. Then your time is said and done on the earth. Then what happens? All your suffering, all your worries, and all your pain, and all your frustration was all concentrated in those 80 years. But the Bible says something great. It says that whosoever believeth in me shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. John 3:16. That's what God promised us. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. For whoever so believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. God didn't say, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. So everything, all your blessings will be concentrated in this life. He didn't even speak about this life. He said, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. So whoever believeth in him shall not perish, shall not die. When death comes and knocks on your door, but they shall live for eternity. They shall not perish. This is our hope, and this is the greatest revelation that a Christian can live by. I want to tell you something, storms will come. Trials will come. But if you live with a sense of eternity tugging at your soul, it will have no power over you. This is what made David. Why do you think David wrote that psalm? And he said, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, when Moses said, 1,000 can fall by my side and 10,000 by right, but none shall come near me. What happened? These were guys that had a sense of eternity. They knew that there was something greater that they were living for. Yes, I may lose a job. Or maybe someone will get angry with me. Praise the God of heaven. Paul said that you should rejoice in the trials that come in your life for the obedience in Christ. People will never understand what you mean for God. So we live our whole life concerned about these things and we forget about what's important. We have to be conscious about heaven. So I want to just focus on that this morning with that final joke and take the focus of our cars and our monies and the blessings of this world that everyone focuses on, which is all good. God wants us to be blessed. God wants you. You need money to buy what you need to buy. But it should never be the focus of your life. Because the Bible says in the book of Timothy that money is good. We all need money. We all need the treasures. We all want a good house. We all want a nice car to live in. We work our whole life learning for these things. But the Bible says in the book of Timothy that the love for money is the root of all evil. Because what it does is it will make you focus on the things that are temporary. These things are going to go. There's a day, even today. Maybe God will say, Pastor Rakesh, your time is up on the earth. It is time for you to come home. Your work is done. I want to tell you something. I don't have time to go and take all my money out and buy myself a good coffin with gold plates on it. Ah, that's all irrelevant things. My time is done on the earth. I'm going home. I'm going to glory. I'm going. Why do we live? I just want to shake your theory a little. Shake your mindset. Why do we live? Why do you come to church on a Sunday morning? Let me change this thing about prosperity all the time. Why do you come to church? Do you come to church so that God can bless your business? Do you come to church so that God can put 10 digits in your bank account? Is that what you come into church for? Then you miss the whole thing. We come into church because we have hope in Jesus Christ, in the blood of the Lamb. We come to church because He said, if you will believe in my Son, you shall not perish, and you shall live for eternity. He said that there will come a day when death will come and knock on your door, and that day it will have no power over you, because the blood of the Lamb covers your heart. And that's what Paul said, oh, death, where is your sting? Are we ready for these things? Do we think about it? Do we think of it enough in this world as we live? Do we really think about eternity? Do we really think what happens after death? Or it's only when we attend a funeral and when the pastor is busy preaching about salvation and about eternity, then we start to think, hey, you know what? It's not so important that this person irritated me. I'm just going to let them go. I'm going to forgive them. It's not important that I lost my job. I know God is going to do something. I know He's going to turn this thing around. But you know what? The most important thing is, if I have to go home today, I know where I'm going. There are two places. There are two destinies. There is hell and there is heaven. And no matter how much you can cover it and turn the scriptures, those two exist. And whatever you do in this life will determine where you are going. This is why we believe in the blood of Jesus. Because we know when we covered in the blood of Jesus, that our future is secure. And when you live life understanding these things, you would find that every other trial in this world seems so irrelevant when our eyes are focused on eternity. Hallelujah. Do we understand that? It's something that the church should be talking about all the time. This is our trump card. Do you understand that? This is our trump card in the world. How do you get someone to be saved? Do you get someone to be saved because you tell them, come to church? God is going to bless your business. My brother and sister, I've learned long ago, I don't serve God for treasures of this world. Because the treasures of this world will come and it will go. Today you may have a good job. Today you may be blessed. Today you may have the best job. And you've got all the money you need. Tomorrow it will all be gone. But the love of God is eternal. It is the same. There is a life where you can be rejoicing in the trials of this world. And it is a life touched by heaven. It must, you know, I was watching an old revival video the other time. I watch it over and over again because it reminds me. The old tiny preachers, you know, that they really preach at home. They preach about sin. They tell you if you sin, you go to hell. No, don't worry, there's grace. God loves you. God will cover your sin. Yes, there is grace, but we serve a God of holiness. And holiness is required. And those days when they preach, the Bible says in the books that I was reading that people were actually literally grabbing the poles of the tent. Because people came and said, we can feel the fire of hell burning under our feet. These are real things. Every time if you live your life with a sense of eternity on your soul, every time you do something wrong, we all fall short of the glory of God. We all will do wrong things. But every time we do it, is there a conviction in your soul? Is there something inside of you telling you, my brother, my sister, do you understand you're doing something wrong? Then you're on the right track. Because there's a conviction of eternity on your soul. But if you continue doing wrong things and saying wrong things and plotting things and all of that, and nothing is convicting in your heart, then there's something wrong. Then eternity is not, you're not conscious of eternity. Your mindset, your life is about this day. It's about blessing. It's about today. But there's something greater than today. Whatever you invest in must be greater than today. You are carrying eternity inside of you. The greatest gift that anyone on the earth can receive is eternity. It is worth more than all the gold and all the silver of on the scale of life, it will find itself wanting. All the trials in this world can never add up to salvation. Do you understand this thing? There will come a day when we will walk on the streets of gold. There will come a day when we hear the words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." In that day, it didn't matter who came against you. It didn't matter what trials you went through. It was all about that moment. This is what being a Christian is all about. I don't care what I go through. I don't care what people say about me. But I know if this is the day I go home, I know where I'm going. And that's what it is. This is the most important thing. Your end, my brother and sister, is good. That's what I want to tell you today. It doesn't matter where you were born. It doesn't matter what situation you were born in. It doesn't matter what type of mother or father you got. It doesn't matter what type of financial situation you find yourself in. Your end is good. It doesn't matter if you don't own a Ferrari like your friend next door. It doesn't matter if you don't own a business like someone down the road. But your end is good. This is what we need to understand. Our end is good. And all these things that we put our focus on, we're going to leave it all behind. It is for here. It is for now. Yes, God wants us to have all of that. But we must understand that God blesses us just for now. It is not the focus. It is not the bar by which you measure your righteousness and your standing with God. Money does not measure your righteousness with God. A poor man will be more rich than a rich man in the things of God. A man that has nothing. A man that is staying on the street. His heart may be so full with eternity that on the scale of eternity, the man who has all the money will be found wanting. Come on. We gotta put the right thing in perspective in our life in this time. Listen to what the book of Thessalonians says. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 9. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. The Bible is saying God did not appoint you for pain. God did not appoint you for trials. God appointed you for salvation. The end of all this thing is salvation. The end of everything that you will go through on the earth is salvation, and that is good. And that is not changing. That is not subject to the coronavirus. That is not subject to your economy. It is not subject to your job. It is not subject to your money. It is subject to the blood of Jesus. And this is where we need to be in this day. We need to understand these things. Listen to what Paul says a few verses before he got to that point. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 14. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those that will fall asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise. Then we who are alive remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. It's a funeral scripture, isn't it? So you're probably saying, Pastor, come on, man. This is Sunday morning. We're not burying anyone today. But we need to remind ourselves of these things. Paul says that even if you die, when God comes, when Jesus comes for us, you will rise first. So even death has no power over this end that you have. Do you understand that? How glorious is that? We're too concerned. Maybe you lost a loved one. Maybe you lost someone close to you. And the devil is causing you to doubt and to question God's loyalty in your life. But I want to tell you, when Christ comes, that one that you love will rise first. That's what the Bible says. And they will meet you there. No one is going to get left behind. You have the ticket. And that ticket is worth more than all the gold and all the silver of this world. You hold on to that ticket. You don't let no one steal that ticket. You don't let any situation in this world steal that ticket from you. That ticket is the blood of Jesus. Don't you somehow make it happen. The problem, I think, is we need to preach more of this in a time such as this. We need to remind people that, you know what? There's something greater. Look inside you. Focus on this thing. I'm going to go through some examples just now, and you'll see how the great men and women of God, how they overcame the trials of this world. We only read the good stuff. In the Bible, we read the good stuff about Paul raising the dead, raising people that are sick and calling demons to come out of people and turning around and saying, come out, and we hear all these great stories. But what was his life about? About, sometimes people will look at the pastor and say, oh, he's so anointed when he's at the pulpit in the glory of God. But when I leave the pulpit, I'm going home to a normal life. I'm facing normal situations. How do I overcome these things? How do I, that went through stuff in my life, and I come here and someone in church is going through the very same thing, and I need to pray for them. But little do they know that I'm going through something worse than what they're going through. How do you do that? By living with a sense of eternity. Don't love God. I hear people say, but I've been tithing, I've been serving God, I've been worshiping God, I've been giving God all my life. But look at my life. I still don't have the job I desire. I still don't live in the area I want to live in. But did you once look inside? Did you once think about, if you died today, where would you go? That's where all your worship went to. That's what all your faithfulness to God's house has been bringing in your life. You don't see it. You don't see it. The things that you do for God, the faithfulness that you walk with your God, that every time you read your Bible, every time you worship God, it is not about what is happening all around you. This is why I said, do not measure your walk with God by what you have. It's irrelevant. Look inside. Look inside and find what God is doing in your life. Do you understand what I'm saying this morning? We get sidetracked in this world. And we're going to lose everything. We're going to lose the main thing. Keep the main thing the main thing. The main thing is salvation. The main thing is that if you deny Christ, you lose a life of eternity in the presence of God. These things are real. And we need to understand this. The Bible says in the book of Romans chapter 8, God did not promise us a life of carefree stuff. You know, sometimes we think, God, we become Christians and then we'll never go through things. I want to teach you something this morning. Bible never told us that. The Bible says that even though you go through storms, even though you have to face certain things, God will be there. And when we think that every time, I mean, we're going to look like children. Remember last week I was a bit hard on everyone. And I was calling our teenagers, remember that? And throwing our toys out of the pot. And that's what happens when you don't have this understanding. Every time something goes wrong in your life, oh, God left me. Oh, all your toys are thrown out of the pot. I give up. God doesn't love me. Why is it happening to me? But if you look inside, you will see God is still there. He never went anywhere. That's your hope. That's your strength in God. Listen to what Paul says in the book of Romans chapter 8. Let's read from verse 35. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trials and tribulations, distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Did you ask yourself that question any day? Did you wake up in the morning, look in the mirror and say, what will separate me from this love that I have for Jesus? Is it because everyone acknowledges me? Because wherever I go, people will see the anointing in my life and say, oh, you're such a blessing and I'm doing so much for God. Is that what it is about? What will separate you? What has the power? Paul is asking a question. Who shall separate you? What shall separate you from the love of God? You ask yourself that question this morning. Is it subject to everyone doing what you want them to do? Is it subject to the world acting the way you want it to act? Is it subject to your job being the way you want it to be? Is it subject to your family being the way you want it to be? Who shall separate you from this love? From this this joy that you have inside of you, of eternity? What shall separate you? These are questions that we need to ask ourselves in prayer. These are the questions that determine who we are and where we are being with God. Verse 36, as it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, no angels, no principalities, no powers, no things present, no things to come, no height, no depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Do you understand that this is the secret that Paul learned? This is what your Christian life is about. What shall separate you? Where are you focused on? Are you focused on things around you, or are you focused on the things of God? In the book of Colossians, I think it is, in chapter 3, there Paul says, be mindful of things above and not things on the earth. Focus on these things, and your life shall be focused in the right direction. We must live with a sense of eternity. The book of Peter, listen to what Peter says. Peter says in the book of 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 19, for this is commendable, if because of your conscience towards God, one endures grief, suffering wrongfully. For what credit is it if when you are beaten for your faults, you take it patiently? But when you do good and suffer, if you take it patiently, this is commendable before God. So sometimes we're going to go through some stuff. But does it determine where you stand with God? Does it change your perspective of God? What is important to you? Hallelujah. Everyone's quiet now. I'm going to start a fire and brimstone just now. And then everyone's going to get excited. Hallelujah. That's the thing. We're not living in a time where we need to be moved. If we want the fire and the brimstones all the time, and this is how our mentality was with God. We want our business to be successful. We want our marriage to be good. We want everyone around us to just acknowledge us and say, oh, you're so good. You've been everything right. Life will never be that way. We got to say it as it is. What are we teaching our children? What are you teaching your children? They're listening to what you're saying at home. They're listening to how you speak about the things of God. They and you are raising up another generation. So when everything's been good, praise the Lord, hallelujah, God is good, God is faithful. And then when you go through some seasons, oh, God is like this, why God is doing that to me? What about eternity? What about eternity? It should be the focus, it should be the center of your life. When you pray because you know one day you're going to be before your God. When you fast, you have a sense of eternity. Heaven must guide us, heaven must lead us. This is what Jesus said when he walked the earth. He says, I do nothing unless I hear my Father doing it. No one wants to hear these things. Everyone wants to hear the fire, the brimstone. Oh God, the Holy Spirit is going to come and he's going to fill us and he's going to empower us. God's going to raise up our business. God's going to bless you. We like all those things. I can sit here and I can start prophesying over you. Oh, that's it, the Lord. You're going to be blessed. Your children are going to be blessed. This is going to be blessed. That's going to be blessed. But God is also requiring that you focus on him. You allow heaven to lead you and to guide you. Be focused on things above and not things beneath. These are required things. This is why I told you that one day I saw a sister from church in Builder's Warehouse smacking a worker so hard I could even hear it. And all these guys in the till, now they all know me as pastor. If I go to Builder's Warehouse and they say, Pastor, how are you? Must come and pray for the people at the page. Because I was there. And how it hurt me to see a woman of God coming and worshiping in the very church. They're not China. No, they don't look that up. And then I'm hearing this woman clapping this man, like hitting him and shouting and taking him in the back of the sun and slapping him because he works for her. And all these guys are saying, how can she hit him like this? And then I went to the front and the Lord told me, go and talk to this woman, she can't do that. And as I approach her, I see a daughter of the house doing this thing outside church. And I tell him, why? I'm not saying your name, so forget about it, let's move on. And so I said, why are you doing this thing? Oh no, they did this, they did that. Yes, it's all good, but do you understand what you are doing? Is it the right thing? Is it taking you away from heaven or towards heaven? When you think about someone that does something bad to you, when you plot and connive and manipulate situations, do you think what this thing is going to do to your place and your ticket in heaven? When someone does something to you, the way you respond to them, do you take in consideration heaven? This is what Jesus was saying. I do nothing unless I see my Father doing it. What he was saying is, my decisions on the earth are moved by heaven. That's simply what Jesus was saying. Don't just do things. Don't just act. Don't just speak things that you don't even know. Sometimes we look at things in our perspective. We don't know the big picture. And you end up coming against the anointing, coming against the plan of God. Where does that leave you in eternity? Hallelujah.
Amen.
But God loves you either way. And so we look at the 2 Corinthians chapter 11, and I just want to speak on the great Paul that we think that loved God so much. Everything in his life was so rosy. Paul was so blessed. Everything worked out. No. Listen to his life. He tells a story. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 24. From the Jews, 5 times I received 40 stripes, minus 1. I don't know why he didn't just say 39. 3 times I was beaten with rods, once I was stoned, and 3 times I was shipwrecked. A night and a day I had been in the deep, in journeys often, in perils of water, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils of the Gentiles, in perils of the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils amongst false brethren, in weariness and toil, in sleeplessness often, in hunger and in thirst, fasting often, in cold and nakedness. Where is your problems? Where is your problems? This is the Paul that we read, that went and preached the gospel, wrote 3/4 of the New Testament. How did he do this thing with all of these problems? Did you ever get locked up or spend the night in prison for the gospel of Jesus Christ? Did they take you out on the streets and stone you for preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ? Have you ever been persecuted for God? Have you ever got 39 lashes from God? Have you ever slept sleeplessly because of what you believe in God? Have you ever stood for Jesus? What made Paul still do what he did with all of these trials? It tells me a story of a man that was not moved by what was going on around him. Why? He was too focused on heaven. He was too focused on eternity. When he was lying down like this and they were slashing his back with that book, I can just imagine Paul. His eyes was saying, oh Lord, I know that you are with me. Even though I go through this valley, Lord, I know that you will never leave me. How do you do things like that? Look at it here. You think when Paul was worried about his car and his house, Paul was worried about his big house and his fancy car? Oh, I wonder whether I put my alarm on. Huh? You think he was saying that? Oh, I wonder whether the alarm response is activated. Did I activate the electric fence? Did I put my alarm on in my car? Oh, God. Did I park under the tree to save my car? Oh, in those days, you're not worried about those things. You need grace. And this is what God was saying. This is what God was saying through the scriptures with Paul. We have to change our focus. Don't live like paupers. Don't say, oh, pastor is saying we must suffer and be poor in the earth. I'm not saying that. I'm saying don't be focused on it. Don't run after the treasures of the earth and leave God behind in the process. That is the problem. That is the problem. People are too concerned about that. I can fill up every chair in this church if I change the way I preach. I can do it very easily, but I will not, because of the fear of eternity in my heart. I will preach what God tells me to preach. I can start preaching about prosperity and grace and God loves you and God's going to bless you. And I can lie to people. But where does that leave you? What does that do in your life? Amen? So these are the treasures of the kingdom of God. Listen to some examples quickly and then I'll finish. Just a little more endurance from your side on these hard doctrines that pastor's given you recently. But I believe that it is required for a time such as this. Look at Jesus in the book of Matthew chapter 16, or verse 21. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised the third day. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, far be it from you, Lord, this shall not happen to you. But he turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me, for you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men. You see, we find a scenario where Jesus was trying to tell his disciples, listen, I'm going to go through some stuff on the earth. I'm going to be crucified. But I want to tell you something. On the third day, I'm going to rise again. What he was telling Peter, I'm going to tell you what's happening here on the earth. But I want your focus to be on the third day. I want you to be focused on what happens when I rise again. There's a great blessing. But Peter was too focused on the natural. Peter wanted Jesus now. He didn't want the blessing of heaven. And sometimes we are like that. We want the blessing of now, but we forget about the blessing of eternity. We want the treasures of the world now. And God is saying, maybe you will lose some things, maybe you'll go through some stuff, but there is something greater waiting for you. Amen. Amen. I remember I had a glimpse of the realms of God a long time ago when I was a young man, just got saved about 19 years ago, I think it was in our church once, and I had this vision of, I think it's heaven. And I was worshiping God and the whole church, the roof just flew away. And all the walls of the church just came down. And I found myself in this field. I cannot explain to you the joy that I felt. I cannot explain to you the smells that I smell. The flowers that touches your soul. There is a place greater than this world can ever give you. Maybe you never tasted it, but I'm here to tell you that I saw it and I smelt it and I know it's real. And when you walk in the streets of gold, I tell you something, my brother and sister, the strength of the storms of this world will have no power. You forget about all the people that came against you. In that moment when the glory of God comes, when you walk in His presence, all of this world has no pull on your soul any longer. This is what we live for. Forget about the 10 points of living this and 20 points of being that. There's only one way. Love your God with all that you are. This is what the church needs to understand. Love Him. Forget about everyone around you. We come to church to worship God. We come to church to give Him praise. We come to church because He is God. And one day I'm going to bow before Him for eternity. I never come to church to look at everyone around. I love everyone, but I don't come for your soul. I come for God. And this is the thing. I wake up in the morning for the will of God. Otherwise, we're going to be rats in this world. You know, like you look at a rat in a cage. Its whole world revolves around that. And it runs. Or what is it? Not rats like hamsters or something. They've got these wheels and they run. The whole day it will run and run and run just for that little food that it gets at the end of the day. And eat that food and sleep. And then it wakes up in the morning and it starts running again. Running, running. I want to tell you, run all your life. And this life will go past you. And you will never. people are focused on those things. This life, family, a marriage, children are the greatest blessing that God has given us in this life. Because the Bible says in heaven we shall not marry. And we shall not be given into marriage. These are the treasures that God gave us on the earth. Enjoy it. God wants you to have good houses and good cars. God wants you to live and taste the treasures of this world. But it should never be the focus of your life.
Come on. Amen.
That's what I'm trying to get at this morning. Hallelujah. Now listen to this quickly. Peter was earthly minded. He wanted Jesus for now.
Yeah.
And the Jesus was trying to tell him, listen here, Peter, get some heavenly thoughts in your head for once. You're always talking too much. Peter's always there. Jesus is trying to tell him, stop talking and listen to the Spirit. But Peter never understood this. So Jesus had to rebuke him. And sometimes when you walk in your life and you are heavenly minded and you are heaven bound, people around you that are earthly bound, they don't comprehend what you're talking.
Yeah.
And sometimes you have to tell them, Satan, get behind me. Because I'm going somewhere. I'm not going to allow you to change my destiny. I'm not going to allow you to reset my coordinates. I will not allow that. Is heaven that important to you? Will you allow the lust of this world to reprogram your coordinates? No. My GPS is set with the blood of Jesus. It is heaven bound. Nothing is going to change it. No one is going to change where I am going. And if you get offended along the way, then that's all good with you. But I am heaven bound. Are you heaven bound today? Are you heaven bound and never looking at the treasures of this world? I'm going to taste it as I go along. But if I need to leave it, I leave it and I carry on. Because the God that gave me this will give me that.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Listen to what happens after that. The Peter that did not understand the things of God. In the book of 1 Peter, remember he said, now the same Peter who didn't understand what it is to suffer a little bit for God after the Holy Spirit was in him, he says, you know what? It's actually commendable for you to suffer a little for God. That's what he said in the first book of Peter. What happened? It is the Holy Spirit that brings the awareness of heaven in your heart. It is only the Holy Spirit that brings the fear of God to dwell within your soul. Listen to what the book of John says, John 16. And many of us, we say that the Holy Spirit is in us. The Holy Spirit is not just for us to fall in the church. The Holy Spirit is not just for you to shaka, brondo, zaranando, kalure, shekera, bronda. The Holy Spirit is not just for that. The Holy Spirit is to lead you in the path of God. Anyone can prophesy. Anyone can speak in tongues. It's a gift of God. But how you live your life is the problem. Listen to what it says. John 16 verse 13. However, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you in all truth. For he will not speak on his own authority. But whatever he hears, he will speak. And listen to this. And he will tell you things to come. That is the key of the Holy Spirit. He will tell you of things to come. He will remind you, hey, my brother, my sister, don't do these things. They're not worth it. And then he starts to focus you onto the things of God. This is eternity. This is where you are going. Is this thing really worth it? That's what I do. Before I jump into something, I always sit back and say, will this thing affect where I am going? What my decisions are going to be? Will it affect me? Will it detour me? And this is what we do in our life. We heaven bound. And we allow the things of this world to come into our hearts.
Yeah.
And detour us. Make us go around the mountain. And then you find yourself 5 years down the line. I'm still in the same place. And everyone around me is gone. Obviously, you use an example of when we were in Pastor Jeff's church and we were in the first ordination class, and there were many people in the church that were in that ordination class, But I tell you something, whenever we used to listen, we alienated ourselves from all of them. Because when we listen to them, oh, why Pastor Jeff did this? Why Pastor Marlene did that? Why the worship team did this? Oh, it's like this, it was like that. They spent their whole life wasting time going around the mountain, resetting their coordinates. God put them on the path to destiny. I know many of them are anointed, set apart for the glory of God, raised up with the power of the gospel burning inside of them. But today they're still sitting in the church. Because they reset their coordinates too many times. Every time you get distracted, then you go around the mountain. 15 years later, I rock up in the church, preaching, preaching the service. And I look in the crowd and I see there's my brother and sister that's still sitting on that chair. And many of us, God has ordained us for great things. Not everyone is to preach the gospel at the pulpit. But when God comes again and visits you, he finds you in the same place. There's greater things, my brother and sister. There are greater things that God wants to give you. You may be carried away with what you've got now, but I tell you something, these things are just a speck of what God wants to give you. Many times we forfeit our blessings because we get carried away with today. And this is what Jesus was telling Paul, Peter. You want me for now. You enjoy the presence of God when I'm around you. You enjoy seeing people healed. But if you will allow me, what you think is a blessing to you now will become a greater blessing. When I die, and when I go to my Father, and when I send the Holy Spirit to you, oh Peter, you got no idea what is about to happen. Do you understand what I'm saying? Peter didn't see the season where the shadow was healing people. Peter didn't see the season where he preached a sermon and 3,000 people got saved. But at that moment, Peter thought it was the best blessing ever to have Jesus with him. And you may think now what you have is the best blessing ever in your life. If you will just stay focused to God, I tell you something, what is coming is greater than you have ever tasted. Amen. Peter could not fathom or think about him preaching and 3,000 people got saved, but it was coming. And that's what happens in our life. Yield to the Holy Spirit. Don't go around detouring, getting distracted from this world. Everything you do must be heaven bound. Young people, if you find someone that is more worldly, oh, they'll come to you and say, like my daughters tell me in school, there's some people talk to them and they're more concerned about the things of this world. I tell them, just leave them alone.
Yeah.
Don't even bother about them. You just leave them and you carry on running. You don't waste your time to stop for someone that's not willing to run.
Amen.
You got a race to run, my brother and sister.
Amen.
And the end of that race is eternity.
Amen.
Don't be moved. Young ladies, young men, you meet a young person that you want to spend the rest of your life with. If they are not heaven bound, if they're not interested in the things of heaven, you don't be interested in them. They're going to detour you. They're going to make you go around the mountain with all the lust of this world. They may have all the big chairs for the girls with the flowing hair and everything. They will derail your destiny. As Delilah derailed a sense of destiny. Remember that. Now let's look at another one. In Acts chapter 8, we learn of a man called Stephen. And the Bible says, while he was speaking of the gospel, they wanted to stone him. And he said, behold, I see the Son of God standing at the right hand side of the Father. What does that tell you? Stephen was in a persecution, but his eyes was on heaven. Read it. Let's go to the scripture. Acts chapter 8, verse 54. Acts chapter 8, verse 54. Is that correct? Acts chapter 7. When they heard these things, they were cut to the heart. Acts chapter 7, verse 54. When they heard these things, they were cut to the heart and they gnashed at him with their teeth. But he, being full of the Holy Spirit, job of the Holy Spirit is not to just make you rattle and roll in the church, or shaka brondo, or make you pray so that you feel you're all anointed and holy. No, the Holy Spirit is to focus you on heaven. That's his job. And he, being filled with the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the Son of God standing at the right hand side of the Father. When we learn how to be filled by the Holy Spirit, to look into heaven, in our storm, the storms have no power over you. That's what happened with Stephen. They were ready to stone him. They actually stoned him to death. But I want to tell you something. Not one of those stones Stephen felt, because he was not there. And when you live your life focusing on the stones of this world, you will feel every stone.
Yeah.
But when you live your life focused on heaven, filled with the Holy Spirit, this is what the Holy Spirit should be doing in your life. He should be causing you to gaze into the heavens.
Amen.
And when you live your life gazed into the heavens, moved by heaven, they can stone you. Those stones will mean nothing. Even if I die, I'm going to heaven. It doesn't matter. Stephen didn't care. He said, "Behold, I see the Son of God standing at the right hand side of the Father." Even standing somewhere, not even sitting. Giving him a standing observation. Because the Bible says Jesus will sit at the right hand side of the Father. But Stephen saw him standing. So when you live your life focused on heaven, even the Son of God will give you a standing observation. So what does that tell me? It tells me when a man and a woman lives his life or her life in the earth focused on heaven, when that day when you walk through the gates of heaven, there's going to be some great celebration.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, Caesar, but when I walk into heaven, I want to make a noise. I am alive! Hallelujah! I want heaven to make a noise! This is how we live our life. This is what the Holy Spirit wants us. Paul says in the book of, let's read what Paul says in the book of Philippians chapter 1 verse 21. He says, to live is Christ, but to die is gain. Do you understand that? These are powerful statements. To live is Christ. To live is to do the will of God. And to die is gain. But when you live your life fearful of death, you're living a life without a revelation of heaven. I've got to the point where if it's my time, it's my time. We need to go. We all can't stay here forever. We were never meant to stay here forever. Do you understand that? It is not your destiny to live for eternity on the earth. This body cannot hold eternity. The Paul says of a body that is glorified that we will receive. So enjoy what God has given you on the earth, my brother and sister. Enjoy it. But don't live for it. Live and embrace what God has given you. He gives you a good job. Be thankful. Nurture it. And live off the benefits of it. He gives you a good house. Enjoy your house. Don't live in a cluster, oh, I don't need you. I will go and stay. Pastor said, I must suffer on the earth, so I'm going to sell this house and I'm going to stay in a one-bedroom house. I never said that. Enjoy all of it. But don't live every day. Don't wake up in the morning and say, oh, now I'm going to go run my race. Don't be like that hamster, running the whole day for a salary. Don't live your whole life. I want to tell you a story of human life. We live as children, we go to school all our life till we're 18, 21, say 24 after you get your honors, your masters. Then you go work. And then you live your whole life working for someone else's destiny.
Yeah.
Running your life, waking up 6 o'clock in the morning, working till 8 o'clock, neglecting your family, missing your child's soccer practice, missing their plays, running and running for someone else's destiny. And then you reach the age of 65 and you're all, hallelujah, at retire, and you get your money and 2 years later you're dead. You lived your whole life for that. Is it worth it? Is it really worth it? These are questions we need to ask ourselves. Maybe as we get older, we start thinking of these things more. But even as we are, if we set our course correctly now, nothing is impossible for you. Nothing. And when I stand at funerals and I give my sermon, I hear people tapping each other. I can see it in their spirit. They remembered that, you know what, hey, let me snap out of this rat race of life. I'm not here forever.
Yeah.
I got to make some things right. I got to invest correctly. And so, maybe today is not the sermon you wanted to hear, but it's just to tap on your door and tell you, hey, get a wake up. I'm speaking to myself also. There's more to this life. Prioritize it. Do the correct thing. Focus correctly. Because today, you could go home. And all that was important, this morning, we in God's house, no lies. How many of you all prayed at home before you came to church? How many of you all read those Bible through this week? But how many of you all miss work this week? No one. How many of you all start work from 8 to 4, you're at work at 8 o'clock? Without a doubt, it doesn't matter if you had a family function last night, you went to bed late, you will wake up. If you have 2 hours sleep, you will wake up and go to work. You're investing in this thing. But the things of God, you know what, today I don't feel like praying, I'm not going to pray. Today I don't feel like reading my Bible, I'll read tomorrow. The Bible will still be there. Why? You see our priorities. And then, how would you face, and I close, I promise I'll close with this, just a little bit more fear to put in my heart. Then I'm done. I don't feel like touch on it. Really feel for it. You woke up for the last week and you never prayed. You did something to people. Maybe someone told you something, or you went through some stuff. You did something. We all do things that are not Christian. Like, come on, let's not be all holy and righteous. We all do wrong things. And that particular day, you find yourself in the throne room of God. How do you stand before God? Did you ever think of that? That day when you spoke against the anointing of God, maybe that will be the day that you will stand before the King of Glory. How are you going to stand before God? Forget about Pastor Rakesh, I'm no one. How are you going to stand before God? What are you going to tell God? All of heaven will be there. All the elders will be around the throne room of God, waiting for you. What are you going to say? Oh God, I want to leave you with this. Don't enter heaven like this. Oh, I'm so embarrassed. I'm so embarrassed. Then you see David standing there. Oh, David, I'm so embarrassed. No, walk into heaven knowing that I've walked this life. I've walked this life. And I loved it. And in walking and in living this life, I never took my focus off Jesus. There will come a day, my brother and sister, where we will all stand before our Maker. And no man and no woman, neither rich nor poor, will escape that appointment. We all have that appointment. Nothing you own on this earth, nothing you do on this earth, will forfeit that appointment. And what would you say? It is the greatest appointment of your life. It is the day you stand before your King. What will you hear that day? Well done, my good and faithful servant. Oh, here you go. Can you smell the brimstone and fire? Every man and every woman and every child has that appointment. And you can't escape it. That is the greatest investment you can invest in this life. No matter what else everyone tells you, at the end of the day, it comes down to that. So live your life correctly, invest correctly. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Does God love me? Let's stand to our feet. Let's just thank God for the things that He has given us. But I just felt in my spirit this morning, that scripture came to my spirit. And I feel that we need to not forget about what's important in life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, I bless you and I thank you for this day. I thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in your people's hearts. Lord, as we live this life, may we live it with a sense of eternity coming in our soul. I want to give a call out to everyone online here. If you have never known Jesus, this is the entrance, the blood of the Lamb. And if you receive Him as your Lord and Savior, you have right to this eternal life. And today I want to give you a chance. If you're online, if you have never known Jesus, if you're here in the church, maybe I don't know, you don't know Jesus. Maybe you're not sure of where you'll be if you die today. I want to tell you something, sitting in church does not mean that your ticket is secure. It is your heart. Where is your heart today? You can be in God's house, but your heart can be elsewhere. If that's you, I want you to just make a commitment inside of your soul today. You online, if you have never known Jesus, I want you to say a prayer with me. Say, Lord Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God. And I believe that God rose you from the dead. Come into my heart and be my Lord and be my Savior. And if you said that prayer, the Bible says that you are saved. Now live a life in line with the Word of God. Hallelujah. You find yourself a Bible-based church, or you send us an email at kingdompark@joyministry.co.za and we will help you.